Hello everyone, my name is Cristian Negulescu. You know me for a lot of automation UiPath. We have the Salesforce connector, ServiceNow connector, Jira connector, and so on. I have a lot of general videos about UiPath. Today we'll talk about forms. So basically inside of UiPath, you are able to create forms to get the data, to interact with the robot, and so on. So to be able to work with these forms, you need to install some packages. So first, you have to search for UiPath form activity. So you will go to all packages, go to UiPath form activity and click install. Also, this form will return a JSON. So you need to deserialize this JSON. To be able to do this, you have to install also UiPath web API activities. So you search for web API activities, UiPath web API activities, and install this stuff. After you install this stuff, you will have the here, if you write forms, you will have the these forms. I will use just create form in my case to show you what I am able to do with different types of forms. And then on the JSON, you will have the JSON, will have the deserialized JSON that we'll use in our case. Done. Let's talk about simple example, and then let's explain what is inside. So basically, the main idea is you go create a sequence test. Then you will put an create form, for example. Form, I'm not focus, or I'm focus. Okay, form. Okay, create form, open the form. Here you can drag and drop a lot of stuff. We'll discuss step by step. Here this field has an the name of the property. So let's put text one, test one. It's also perfect like this. Then you can have a preview from here. There I put a text area. Text area means with multiple lines, but I just want to show you the main idea. We hit save. Close. This form will return a JSON. So we'll write an str JSON. And then we'll deserialize JSON. This will return will provide him the str JSON. We'll create an object, will be a geo object. And then we'll right-line the value. Our value was test. So let's say geo object item test, yeah? Test one. To string. So in this way, very fast, I create a form, and we'll go to deep with different. So I have here something like this. I will hit submit, and you see my text area is this one. Yeah. So this was very fast. How do I create this form? So you have the creator. This will return a JSON. The JSON will be deserialized, and then I will access the element from the JSON. Remember that for JSON and for complicated JSON, I have here a dedicated video. Yeah, so I have this video with JSON that has a lot of view on my channels, and this I show you how to work with multiple types of JSON. Yeah, I have four different use cases of creating or deserializing JSON. Good. Now, let's take a simple example and let's see on what I use this stuff. So for example, I did an automation where I have to decide. So I have the decision. Basically, I did something from the finance, and the finance asked me, look, we have to select the quarter and the year. Now, the quarter inside of the company is not necessary to be from January to April, from April to June, and so on. So each company can adjust this type of quarters. Yeah. So the target was when they start the robot, they have to select the quarter. Like I said, the quarter can vary in each company. Select the year and then go further. So let's see what was here. So basically here was, I deserialize the JSON. I write the JSON on the screen. So here I write the string JSON on the screen to see how the data is coming. Yeah, then I extract the quarter like this. Basically I say scene, job type, val, quarter. We'll see exactly where I define all this stuff. And here, basically I extract the year, val year, yeah? And scene is converted into it. And then I will just write this on the screen, the values. And then with these values, I will create my quarters. So in case I have value one, this is the first quarter, second quarter, third quarter, and I will initialize with a new date. So I say this is starting from July, this is starting from October, and so on. Yeah. And for the end of the date, I just add 3 months to the quarter. So from the starting day, I add another 3 months, and that gives me the quarter. And here, you can see that I select third quarter, and it's from July to October, yeah? To 1st of October, yeah? This is the quarter. And in this way, I create my interval. So I select these values, I deserialize, I extract the data, and then I create my interval where I make the filters. Now, let's understand what I configure inside of this one. So inside of this one, in my case here, I just drag and drop drop-down list, yeah? So this, you can call it in C#, it's called it combo box. In other software, it's called drop-down list. It's the same idea. Now, how I populate this data? So here, when you configure an element, you have the display, what it's showing on the screen. So select quarter test, let's say. Good. Then you have the position where you have to put it. You have a lot of custom stuff. But in our case, what is important? The important is field key. Field key is the value of the variable that will be returned. Yeah. So here, for example, I define val q. That means this is the value of the quarter. So this is the value that I will read from JSON. Remember that here on the output, I have that stuff on JSON. So from here you define the property, and based on this property name, you know what you do on JSON. And here for data, what I did, I put here labels. I put them, so you have to add the values. You add values. And let's say that we have a quarter five imaginary. And we'll put the value five like this, yeah? So I prefer to put, in my case, in values. Here I can put also string values, or I can copy paste what is on the label. So the label is also what is on the screen, and the value is the stuff that I will receive on the JSON. So in my case, I prefer to put integer values, because this will be very easy to use on the switch, yeah? Don't make other conversion. Okay, so this is the thing that I configure for the, you will see here that here on this Dropbox, I was able to complete only one value. If I want to select multiple values, you have to click on this one. We'll see together on the next example what's the idea with multiple values. So this is what I configure on the first one. And on the second one, I configure again, I put the years. So I say select year, let's put again test. Here it's my field key, which will be val of the year. And then I put some data to populate this this system, yeah? You can put validation, you can put different stuff, but this is too complicated from the beginning, yeah? So in this way, I was able to create a simple window where I'm able to ask for the quarter and the year where I want to make the calculation, yeah? So here I can make a preview. I can see how the system is working and so on, yeah? I can change the size from here. So I can change the size of my window. So it's important, this one, to see it on a preview, how the designer looks, yeah? Good. So let's hit save. And close. And if we run it, I forgot to put something maybe inside. Good. So that was the idea with this one. Now, remember that I showed you that you can do multiple selects. So if for multiple selects, I will go to this part. And inside of the combo box, you'll see that I can put multiple selects. So I have the same combo box. And on this combo box, take a look here. I have now the data will be the months, January, March, May, and so on. And I configure again with numbers to be easy for me on the filtering, yeah, when I get the data. So the field will be CB mount from combo box mount. And here on the display, I say multiple values. So I can select multiple values. Okay. Let's hit save. And let's understand how this is working. Yeah, I don't need to save the changes. So when I select their multiple values, here basically I have the combo box, and you can see when I select something, he removed the stuff from my Dropbox, yeah? Because I'm not able to select it 2 times or 3 times. So in this way, I'm able to select multiple mounts or multiple items. So let's say that I want to do a report on March, May, and June, yeah? So when I select the year, here I put a lot of years, and I hit submit. Let's see what I will do here. So the system will return me the mounts and will return me a vector with 3, 5, 6 for March, May, and June. Yeah. And the year, it was 2023. So I will make here, when I deserialize the JSON, then I will say that this one, CB mount, so this CB mount, will be deserialized and will be a vector. But this vector as an argument will have this one, will be as you can see here that it's JSON G value, yeah? And this JSON G value, I will add to a collection. I create here a collection, a list of strings. So I create a list of string to remember all the mounts, yeah? And to this collection, I will add the item to string. So I will extract the GB value. So here I extract the G value, and then I will put this G value on the collection. If I want to see the year, I just go here and I say convert type CB year to integer, and this will return me the year, yeah? And then I will make a for each on that list, the list of mounts, and I will display each mount. So you see, my mounts are 3, 6, and 5. Yeah, it's not on the exact row. But in this way, I extract the here. I just extract the int. I don't display it. Yeah. So let's display it. Let's put here. Mount plus, and let's display also the year. Year, which will be int to string. Okay, done. Let's run this one and let's see again the results. So this is the way how you use multiple select. So I select multiple mounts. I select 1 year. And then on the output, you see on the mounts, I have mount 1, 4, 8, 10, and year 2030. Again, if I was use a case, I use this number, especially to be easy to select a switch case like this to generate my my day of the year correctly, yeah? Good. So this is with multiple select. Let's understand how you can do multiple select in a different way. So, let's go to this one. In this one, you can see that I'm able to select multiple multiple colors, and then I'm also have a question: if I want to filter the columns or not. So in my case, I will merge green and blue, and I will say that I don't want to filter. And let's see the result. So the result is red false, green true, and filter none. Okay. Let's understand what we have inside, and then let's understand how we deserialize this JSON. So here, I use panels. So until now, I use drop-down list, yeah? And I use drop-down list with multiple select. Now, I use here on the layout, I put panels. And this panel, what means? I create here a panel with... with a name, so panel one, yeah. So in this one, I will not put, information on the on this element. I will just put it for the layout. Then inside of this panel, I can put a table, yeah. And here I will say that has number of columns, two, and numbers of rows one, yeah. So you see. Now I have this panel split in two, okay? And then inside of this element, I will put my elements. In my case, my element was checkbox, yeah? So I'll put a checkbox here with the name, and I put another checkbox here with the name. So in this way, I create that this layout, yeah? And for this one, for example, I select the color, yeah? So I select a different color for the panel. Then I was able to put a comment on the panel. Then let's here I put buttons. So here I put buttons, and when I put a button, let's go to the button. Here you have the label, and you have the same field key. Field key is very important. This is the element that you will get inside of the JSON. Yeah, so inside of the JSON, I will take a look on the BTS, and I will see if it was true or false. True means that the button was clicked. False means that the button was not clicked. Yeah. So on this one, I was able to make my decision. Yeah. So I did these panels. I put tables, and inside of the tables, I put the buttons. And here, inside of the panel, I put tables, and inside of the table, I put checkbox. And with this checkbox, I was able to have to offer you an option for multiple select. Yeah. So let's delete this one. I have to remove probably the all the elements step by step. Yeah. So this is my my panels, and in this way I'm able to use here another multiple select, and you can see all the elements, and you have also a decision. Yeah. So remember panels, tables, and then multiple items with buttons, checks, and so on. Good. Let's hit OK. And let's go further with the presentation. And one of the we talk until now a simple one with Dropbox. We talk a multiple select on Dropbox. We'll show panels and layouts and multiple select. But let's come to the basics. The basics here on the panel, basically for each element, I extract the data. If it's Boolean, I extract the item, and I check if it's true or false. Yeah, so that was the decision, simple stuff. But like I said, let's come to the basic, because the basic of this window, it's to add data, yeah? So to add data, you have multiple options. And you have one text field, text one, yeah? Text area, text test one long, line two, line three. Yeah, so you have a text area, line four. Number, here I'm able to put only numbers. I'm not able to put characters. Yeah, password, this will be masked. Here I will use UiPath password, yeah. Here, email. Basically, he will require a format, yeah? At gmail.com. Okay, here it's a phone number. Again, you can put a mask. This is the mask for US, but if you want a mask for Romania, you'll put a different one. Here, you have a data time, yeah? Data time, this could be limited. In my case, you will see inside of the code that this was limited just to select from November to December, yeah? So I select here the date, and I select the time, and I can put the minutes. So remember, we use 2021, 13 November, 7 and 56 minutes, yeah? Let's say like this. Then I can select the day, yeah? So here I put day and time and with everything. If I want to select only the day, I will select the month, and I would say August. I will put 23 and year 2020, yeah? Then I have something special for the time. And if I go here, I can select 2 o'clock, 7 p.m., okay? And then I have the currency. Currency that is set now to US dollars, yeah? And I put it like this. And let's say submit, and let's see the result, yeah? So this is the result where he provide me an a JSON, and let's see how I deserialize this JSON. So I have the text, which was test one. Then I have the text area where I have multiple lines. You see here the multiple lines. Then he was able to extract the currency. You see it's only numbers with points, so I have the decimal there. Then I have the number. Remember the path, which was covered. Here I'm able to get the correct path, so UiPath password. Then the email with the format. Here, like I said, it was the American format for the numbers. Then the date, remember that it was 30 November and we select 7 o'clock and 56. Then the day where I select only the day, and you see that the time it's zero. And then on the time, I able to extract the hours and the minutes. Okay. Let's talk about extraction of the data, and then we'll go inside and see how I configure the interface. So again, the interface deserialized JSON for the text area. I just use this stuff with text extract JSON, text field one, my names from there, text field one, text area, and so on. When I have the number, I use the cint conversion. So basically, I use the cint for the number object to return me an integer. Then I print the number. For the password, I just print it, like email, print it, phone. And on the date, I use, so basically I have the date, the day, and the time. So everything will be configured to convert to C type daytime. So I'll convert to daytime. I have here variables that I define as a daytime. So you can see here, I have three variables that are defined as daytime, yeah? And then with this daytime, I just print it to string. And in case of the time, to show you that it's very easy to follow, on the time, I print the minute and the hour, yeah? So I say daytime variable, sorry, my bad. Daytime variable, time hour to string, and time minute to string, okay? So that's why I printed like this. So the deserialization is standard. Be sure that for the date fields, convert it to date. And then if you want for the number fields, convert it to integer. Let's see what we have on the configuration inside. Yeah. So on the configuration inside, we drag and drop the text field, we drag and drop. And on each one, as usual, very important is to set this correctly. So field key. Because this will be the variable that you'll be able to follow inside of the JSON on the serialization, yeah? Okay, so you have the text area, the number, the password, the email. Here on the phone, you have to put a mask, yeah? So this is the mask that is coming by default. But you see here that you can put a mask. So basically here you can put the Romanian format with plus 40, and then you have three characters, 999, and then like this, yeah? So you can create your own format and other stuff, yeah? Again, field, very important, yeah? Field is very important. On the password, probably you can configure, it's by default. I mean, you have some configuration, but are deep stuff. On the daytime, what I configure there, so again, valid field key, very important. Here on the daytime, you can see that you can put a minimum date and a minimum maximum date. Yeah, and in my case, I put minimum to be November, and look, I can put July with, let's say, 2023 June. So you have a year like this. So you can put a range, yeah, to be able to disable weekends, disable weekday. So you have a lot of configuration that allow your customer to avoid making mistakes. Yeah. So when you configure this type of element, you can put different filters to avoid your end user to make mistakes. Yeah. So remember that you have complete configuration there. Here on the date, again, you can put this on hidden. So basically you don't have the selection of, look, you have here the preview. So basically you have a date, but you select only the, you don't select the month, or you don't select the year. Yeah, so you can configure here what you want to select or no. You have minimum, maximum. Again, there are configuration that allow you to to limit the ability of your customer to provide you dates outside of the range. Yeah, you can see here what is mandatory and so on. Yeah, again, field key, it's very important to know exactly what value you will use on the on the JSON. Yeah, again, here time, other configuration, but you see the configuration here are for the to allow you to make limitation for the people to not be able to add data that are with errors or outside of a definite range. Okay, you can make here a preview to see all the stuff, but I showed you the main utility. Let's go further and let's talk about something else. Let's talk about survey. So on that elements that you see there, you have an element that is survey. Yeah. So for example, he asked me about the skills that I have on some programming language. Yeah. And let's say that this is my skills, and let's understand how you configure this one. So you see the survey provide me. So this, it was the first survey. I just put one survey there. And here my skills for RPA, it's 3, for C, it's 3, and for VB.NET, it's 2. Again, I put the values with numbers to be able to be easy for me to make the filter on JSON. So basically with survey, you just drag and drop here on the advanced, you have the survey. You drag and drop the survey here, and you start configuring. You put the data, the number of questions, the number of values, and so on. So look here, if I put number of values, you can add multiple values here. If I put multiple questions here, I put multiple lines on the... So values are columns, questions are lines, yeah? Let's see how this one is configured. So here I have the names, and I have the values with RPA, C, and VB. And for the skills, I have 1, 2, 3 for the skills. Yeah. again, this is the file, and this one I will use to extract the data. Good. Let's see how I do the data extraction. Again, if you want more complex JSON, you'll follow my YouTube video with JSON, how to extract data from different type of JSON. So here on this one, basically you can see here, I go to survey object, and this survey object will be returned as a, so this will return an array. And this array will be an array of G property, yeah? And on this G property, I will extract the name. I will extract the name of the property, RPA in my case first, and then the value, yeah? So to be able to display this one, I put item name plus item value to string, yeah? So in this way, I was able to display this this stuff, yeah? With my levels of RPA, C, and VB. Good. Let's go to the next one, and it's the last one. And it's about multiple select. Okay, so remember that I showed you the way how to multiple select, and I want to show you another two items. So first one, you can select a file or the folder on the PC. You have a dedicated activity for this. You can have a multiple select with only one selection, and this with radio box. Let's select blue, and you have a multiple select like the last one where we have with checkbox. Let's say select the blue and green, or select red and green. Yeah. Let's hit submit. Let's see the result, and let's see what is inside. So again, this is the JSON that is coming, and then I was able to extract the file location. I was able to see on the radio box that I select blue, and then I know that the red is true and the green is true. How I do this here? On the file location, I just extract the item from file path, the name on the JSON, and here on the selection, let's select again. So here you see that on the selection, you have again a vector of elements, yeah? So the same stuff, you will extract the item SL1, and here, this one will be a vector of G property, yeah? And on the G property, you'll put the name and the value. And here on the configuration, basically you have select box and radios, yeah? So this one is a radio, this one is a select box, and this one is a file and folder. And on this file and folder, you are able to select if you want the window to be for a file or for a folder, yeah? Because sometimes you need to select the folder. Let's say that you download the file from the internet from somewhere and you need to paste the everything on a folder, yeah? You don't need the file to extract from the inside of your RPA. Then here, basically, as Tak mentioned, you have the radio box where you are able to select only one element, and the select box where you are able to select multiple elements, yeah? Again, validation, limitation, a lot of configuration here that, you have also here shortcut keys, yeah? So take a look here, I have some shortcut keys. You believe me? So if I say Control G, I will select green, I will deselect green. So basically I can put the shortcut keys there, and with the shortcut keys, with the hotkeys from the keyboard, I'm able to select stuff, yeah? Good. So that's the idea with what you can do with forms inside of UiPath Studio. As usual, if you like my movies, please come and subscribe to my channel, comment to my movies, and tell me what else you want to see inside of my movies. Thank you very much for watching. Have a good one. Stay